de tua droga, ou tua. How I'm going to talk about principle in emergency management. Now, this topic by itself can take a week of studying, a presentation, and discussion. But I try to make it in 1 hour. So it's only principles. I guess all of you know what is emergency management, what does it mean, and what is it good for. So I will talk more about it than how it is conducted. Now, emergency management is a manage by definition. Definition, what is the meaning of emergency management? It's actually the managerial function charged with creating the framework within which communities reduce vulnerability to hazards and cope with disasters. Everybody knows it, but if you want the definition, that's how it is being defined. Now, what is the vision of emergency management? There are two things, vision and mission. So the vision for emergency management that it seeks to promote safer, less vulnerable communities with the capacity to cope with hazards and disasters. So to reduce the vulnerability on one side, but having the capacity, capability to cope with an incident, with any emergency incident. The mission is actually to protect communities by the keyword coordinating and integrating of all activities. I mean, yesterday we discussed it with MOD about this coordination issue with too many agency or entities, government bodies, that some central agency or body need to coordinate. Because otherwise it will happen like the American in Katrina. Somebody sent the force to do one thing, the other one another thing, and nobody even told them exactly what to do. One force found itself going into a bridge that doesn't exist anymore, the other on the other side, and they never meet, and so on. So the coordination is the key word. All this coordination and integrating of all activities necessary to build, sustain, and improve the capability to mitigate against, prepare for, respond to, and recover from natural disasters, acts of terrorism, or other man-made disasters. So emergency is any disaster. You can have three types. One is a man-made, some fire, some explosion, accident. One is nature, flooding, earthquake, storms. And one is terrorism. So all this we group together as emergency incident. Now, because of this, emergency managers should consider to take into account all phases. Now, there are four main blocks, which consist of all phases of the emergency. We'll talk about each one later. All type of hazards, all impact on the stakeholders. Okay, so when we are talking about emergency, you have to consider the hazards, the impact, the consequences when you prepare for emergency. Now, all phases, what are the phases of emergency? They compare four phases. First of all is the mitigation. Second is preparedness. Fourth is response and recovery. Very simple and very true. Now, what do I mean by all hazards? All hazards, we mean that we have to consider all type of risks or hazards that might cause incident or emergency. And then we have to prioritize them and prepare ourselves to meet them against them. Impact actually is the consequences of the hazard. What will be the impact of the fire you saw in the movie? This fire was very close to a very expensive neighborhood. And I mean expensive neighborhood. Very close. So, if it is a hazard there, you might consider that the fire like this could go into the residential area. So the impact could be a lot worse than just a factory that got burned. So you need to consider the impact of the hazard. So each hazard, what would be the impact? And all stakeholders. Stakeholders meaning the people who are managing the incident on one side, the people who are paying might be affected by the incident. So all these phases need to be considered before you prepare yourself to answer to any emergency. The second point is to have progressive thinking. I mean, once you analyze the hazard, the impact, the stakeholders, then you have to consider what will happen later. Given the escalating risk facing communities, emergency manager must become more progressive and strategic in their thinking. The role of the emergency manager and no longer be that of a technician. So we have the tools, and one of the tools is this system going to be. But the people who are operating have to think what we call outside the box, more progressive. Don't think about, oh, okay, that's a fire, nothing. Think what will happen if. Okay, that's why when you are preparing for emergency, you have to think about the policy and the senior policy advisor, which he needs to address all hazards and all phases of this emergency. Emergency manager anticipates future disaster and takes preventive and preparatory measures to build disaster resistance. Risk-driven assessment. I mean, the first thing that I said was to do a risk analysis. So the risk assessment. The management manager uses sound risk management principle. First of all, you have to identify the hazard, then risk analysis, and then the impact analysis. Mitigation strategies have to be a consequence of this risk analysis. I come back to the integration. Emergency manager ensure unity of effort among all levels of government and all elements of the community. I mean, the unity of effort is dependent on both the vertical and horizontal. Now I can tell you about the American after the 9/11. They set for a few years to write book and to define what kind of capabilities they need to have to face emergency. So they made a very vertical capabilities from the lower level until the top level, from the community to the city, state and the federal. At all levels, they make pillars of capabilities. So what to have intelligence from the lower part to the upper part, what to have responders, all type of responders, and the lower level, county level, federal level, and so on. 36 pillars of capabilities, issues of capabilities. food and prayers to live. They sent to us, we were chosen to analyze this 36 capability list. And we looked at them, we analyzed each of them, and we saw something very strange. There was no horizontal commonality between the capabilities. So you mean, if you talk about intelligence, there was at the lower level, at the country level, at the state level, at the federal level. But there was not across country, across states, across communities, just each by itself. That's why it says here, unity of effort is dependent on both vertical and horizontal integration. Otherwise, each capability is good from top to bottom, from bottom to top, but no one. Because, like, if you take an example, if there's some community having intelligence, at the moment, by the capability, it will go to the upper level, like the state police to the federal, and so on. But it will never go there. So intelligence idea that information that comes from this stays here, doesn't go outside this. So it's very important to integrate vertically, horizontally, and vertically. And this is good at all local level and government level. Plans at all level of local government must ultimately be integrated with and supported the community vision and be considered with its values. So you have to take everything in consideration if you want to be prepared for emergency. Collaboration. Again, emergency managers should create a sustained, broad, and sincere relationship among individuals, organizations, to encourage trust, advocate a team atmosphere, build consensus, and facilitate communications. See how important this collaboration, cooperation, and unity. Teamwork must be viewed as an attitude or an organization culture. This, the coordination is actually a culture of talking to each other, exchanging information, not hiding behind whatever you know, it's only for yourself. The degree of unity and cooperation that exists within the community. In essence, teamwork creates the environment in which coordination and function effectively. In disaster situations, the one factor that is consistently credited with improving the performance of a community is the degree to which there is an open, cooperative relationship among those individuals and agencies involved. To sum up this cooperation, you see how important is this cooperation. Emergency managers should synchronize the activity of all relevant stakeholders to achieve a common purpose. In essence, this principle of coordination requires that emergency manager thinks strategically, see the big picture, and how each stakeholder fits into this mosaic. This type of thinking is the basis for strategic program planning. So, any program, any plan to cope with emergency has to start risk analysis, assessment, impact, stakeholders, and at the end of the day, to have a cooperative work teamwork. Now another issue is the flexibility. Things are changing. They are not the same. If you make a plan, you need to be flexible enough to change the plan, to adapt it to the situation, to different situation, changing situation. Financial managers should be creative, use creative and innovative approach in solving disaster challenges. Flexibility is a key feature of emergency management. Dependent upon it, being able to provide alternate solutions to stakeholders and then having the flexibility to implement these solutions is a formula for success and of emergency management. We finish with the planning, with the thinking, with the analyzing assessment, then we come to the side of the professionalism. There's no more, you know, not being professional with so much information around and so much technical data around that professionalism in the field of emergency management starts to be studied now in universities. Some universities exist in Israel. We have faculty for emergency management, studying emergency management, giving a title in emergency management. Professionalism in the context of emergency management involves science and knowledge-based approach, based on education, training, experience, ethical practice, public management, and continuous improvement. You can have a degree in emergency management nowadays. Now moving to the personal level of emergency manager or responders, there are few very distinguished characteristics about what to expect of the character of emergency manager or good emergency responder. First of all, you should have a desire to help others. Because actually, at the end of the day, what you are doing when you are managing or responding to any emergency, you have to have the willing to help others. Not think about yourself, but about others. That's the first thing. If you take the people who doesn't want to help others, he will never do his job correctly or good. So if you are looking for a good emergency manager or responder, look for people who want to help others. Not religious, but then you have to have the characteristic of do whatever it takes to get the job done. I mean, it's not just, okay, I'll do this and then go away, or you do the rest, I'll just start, you do the thing. But you are thinking about finishing the job, doing it from start to finish. Don't go in the middle, don't leave it in. Now, an emergency manager should be on one side, a guy that has the ability to work alone, to think, to make a decision, or to see the picture. But on the other hand, you also need to have a teamwork. You have to know how to work with the team. It's not by himself. It's not solving the problem by himself. Another thing is the passion or a drive, okay, that cannot be stopped. Because all the time thinking about emergency, how to solve problem, how to manage the emergency. And last but not least, we have to be a guy that always looking for improvement, be better. Either by going to courses or, you know, reading stuff, educating himself. Now, what are the stages of responding to emergency? First problem is to recognize that emergency exists. How do you know? How do you know it's an emergency? I mean, you see a small fire, is it an emergency? could it be a big fire, but just leave it alone? Or on the other side, would you phone 112 and have a fire, a small fire, and raise alarm? So you have to educate the people, or if you are working in a factory, or neighborhood, or community, how to identify a crisis, an emergency, okay? So it says it may look like a very stupid and obvious statement, right? But on the other hand, if you cry or if you alarm for every small thing, then later when something really will happen, nobody will believe it. So people have to be educated, and it starts from the community level. Now, how do you make sure that you are well trained? There's nothing like learning from your past. Analyze incidents, analyze what happens, what caused the fire or the emergency, what were the, you know, the stages of the emergency, how long it took to respond. You saw in the movie, at the end of the time, when was the emergency call, how long the responder came, how long it took them to act, and so what was the decision, whether it was a good decision, or what you saw in the movie was a good example. But we had 2 or 3 years before a very bad example. That the fire, forest fire became a disaster. And the bus with the responders went into the fire and I think 12 people were dying. Okay? So we need to analyze and learn from past experience. Another issue is the equipment. You have to manage your resources and equipment. You have to know what you have. You have to keep it in good shape. Stand by, ready for any emergency. Last but not least, again, prepare for the worst and hope for the best. You have to be prepared for emergency, for the worst case. Sometimes it's too much, sometimes it's good, but it's better to be prepared for the worst. Hope that it will be good. Now, I know that we have another session about GIS, but just a few things I want to mention about technology and GIS, and how this comes into emergency management and cooperation. Because the GIS, first of all, is a technical result system, whatever, that helps to coordinate between entities, helps to talk about the same language, talk in the same language. Because before the GIS, there was some information, but information without proper location can cause a lot of confusion. So the GIS come along, GIS, GPS, same. Before we could say, okay, the streets about 100 meters from this or from that could happen, anything could be there. Now, once the GIS become a very good tool for working, mainly it is a tool for coordination, talking in the same language. So I'm sure you all know and you're all familiar with GIS, but GIS is a geographical information system. It's a data analysis system that allows you to put information on existing maps and to have the same coordination. Now, cooperation and community continuity is crucial to help to make it possible. As I said here, you are probably already using it. You know what it is. But how does it work? What you can get out of it? Need to be all the time study because things are very much changing in this technological world. It's a dynamic things, keep on changing, we need to be ready for it. Now one thing, one outcome out of the year is it allows you to make prediction. One of the things that the GEPSO system is working on is prediction. How is the air polluted will be spread? You can do prediction on this because the GIS is there, it's accurate. The data is getting into the GIS in a more accurate way. So it allows you to do prediction, to predict the situation and know what to expect and how to prepare yourself. This is the revolutionized side of the GIS in emergency. Okay, so this is the thing that, in half an hour, talking about what is emergency management and what we expect in emergency management. And the main point to be considered and the phases to consider about emergency.
Thank you, Amiran.